With Mr. Dark and Zeke absent from the railway for a few weeks, Mr. Chairman had reluctantly stepped in to act as temporary manager of the line. Unfortunately, Chairman was used to running a small society, not a full-on railway company, and struggled on the first day in the role. He came to the sheds to speak to the engines, who looked down at Chairman with some concern, as he looked a bit flustered and unsure of what to say.
Now, everyone, I know that this is a bit of an unusual situation we find ourselves in, but I promise you I will do my damnedest to keep the railway going, even if I have absolutely no idea exactly what's supposed to be done and when.
Don't worry about it, Mr. Chairman. We know what we've got to do.
We're used to running our day-to-day services, and we can work out amongst ourselves who should be doing what, and at what time.
Absolutely. You don't need to worry about trains running, Mr. Chairman. We can work around that. You can continue concentrating on things us engines cannot physically do.
Well, that's very kind and encouraging for you all to say, but I'm very uncertain as to how to manage the railway's finances during these times. It's a big step upwards from running a supporting society.
Brian stepped in. If I may, sir, I have prior experience with handling the line's financial state, seeing as Mr. Dark used to give me those jobs to do back when I was just a banker at Walls Church. If you'd like, I'll sit with you at Mirkum and explain what needs to be done.
You'd do that for me, would you, Brian?
Sure thing. We have enough engines to run service trains at the moment, just about. So I could take some time out to help with the finances and figures during the day, and then take some services in the evening. Would that work for everyone? I could take your services for you if you... But Goose interrupted.
No, sir, I'm on it. I'll be on to help you out during the day. Brian, if you want to help my old buddy or pal chairman?
Well, that's very thoughtful of you, Goose. I'm sure we can arrange for that to happen.
Della Tripp looked down at these words, feeling slightly upset for being shot down mid-sentence. Mr. Chairman continued.
Okay, everyone. Myself and Brian will try to work the financial issues out. If you guys can keep the service trains running, hopefully Nathaniel and Zeke will not be too long with their affairs away from the line. I just hope that there is a solution in sight of all of this.
He hitched a ride back to the station with Brian as the other engines got ready for work. Della Tripp slunk to the back of the sheds, joining the shadows with a still worried looking Clyde, who eyed Tripp with some disdain before moving off to find a different place to lay low, leaving the Montel machine sad and alone. Dave had just arrived at Mirkum Station, ready to haul his first train, when a familiar face rolled into the platforms with his coaches. Alan, who had just returned to service, along with Ryan, after a long period in the works being overhauled. He grinned as he rolled up beside the green engine.
Hey up, bonehead!
Ah, Alan, you're back!
You can't keep a good diesel shunter down. What's been the haps then? I heard we'd lost the mainline connection.
Yeah. But I don't mind personally. I like it here at home.
So do I. Always have. I know nothing different. Always lived here, so it's not affecting me at all. Ryan's not too bothered either.
How is Ryan then?
Not happy to be working at Kolhapa, that's for sure. He's not best chuffed to be working with the DRPS either, after he heard what happened to the Soma branch.
Understandable, I guess. But it isn't wholly Chairman's fault, is it?
No, I guess not. Ah well, at least you're not stuck in the works anymore. And good job too. Something's going down in there.
Dave's curiosity piqued.
Something going down? What do you mean?
Well, Mr. Smash is building something in there, I think, at the back of the facility. He's got lots of materials coming in. I think I saw a set of frames and some wheels too. I think they're building a new steam engine.
Don't be daft, Alan. No new steam engines have been built in this country since the 1960s. Are you sure it wasn't an engine being restored?
I don't think so. I've never seen anything like it before. Lots of wheels. Very big.
Could be a 9F like Barry. Or a Stanier 8F.
I might have to go and have a nosy down there when I finish my shift.
Don't you go in there bugging Mr. Smash. He's busy enough trying to fix Mr. B.
Don't you fret, young Alan. I have another reason for seeing Mr. Smash. Alan tried to question him further, but Dave didn't feel like telling Alan about his vision of Linda.
He would only laugh and spread the gossip around the yards. Coupling to his train, Dave left the station and headed off down the line, thinking about what Mr. Smash had planned in the works and wondered if Alan was mistaken. When his day's work was over, Dave headed up to Carica Smash Limited, poking his smoke box into the works uninvited, only to be met with Mr. Smash shooing him out again.
"But I want to see if what Alan said is true! Alan is a mouthy little bugger, and you're a big green nosy one, Dave. He said you're building a new steam engine, but you can't be. You must be restoring another engine, surely."
"Even if I were, it's not any business of yours, Dave. Your job is to spread joy to passengers, not spread rumours to the other engines. But, no buts. Now, unless you actually have a reason for bothering me just before my 4 o'clock appointment..."
"But I do. I do have a legitimate reason for popping in, sir. You see, the other day, something really weird happened to me whilst I was taking my first train out of Kolhapa." Dave continued explaining how he had felt after this happened, and ever since, he had gotten the feeling that something was wrong with him. Mr. Smash listened and wondered if there was indeed an underlying problem.
"I'll give you a quick look over, but I'm not bringing you into the works. It's too hot in there at the moment. Blasted good weather."
Mr. Smash checked him all over until he found something suspicious.
"Dave, did you say that you've been seeing things that aren't there?"
"Yeah, why?"
"Because I think I've isolated a problem. A couple of bolts and screws are loose around your smoke box saddle. Going to try and tighten them up a bit, see how you feel. No idea how they could have worked loose, unless you've been spending too much time playing hanky-panky with Hannah, of course."
Dave blushed and said no more, as he stood in the cool evening air, as Mr. Smash slowly tightened up the bolts holding his smoke box together. After an hour, Mr. Smash stepped back.
"There you go. How does that feel, Dave?"
"A bit better, but I'll have to wait and see."
"Well, if you have any more issues, don't hesitate to come and see me again. But make an appointment next time, alright?"
"Will do, sir." Dave bade Mr. Smash goodbye as he seamed away towards Kolhapa. The following weeks went smoothly enough as the engine supported Mr. Chairman in his temporary role. Brian was as good as his word, assisting with the railway's finances whilst taking the evening trains as promised. The engines rotated their shifts to give everybody a rest, but Delatrip found himself not being rostered onto as many trains as he would like, and though none of the engines showed any outright hostility to him, he still felt like an outsider among the fleet as they all went around their daily tasks. Finally, the day came that Mr. Dark and Zeke returned to the railway, calling for a big meeting at Mearcombe Sheds, with everybody present to hear what the conclusion was of their visit to London. Mr. Dark spoke first.
"Now everyone, I know that some of you have been worried about the loss of our main line connection at Kolhapa, and probably have been wondering what myself and Zeke have been doing for the past couple of weeks. We assume that you have managed to wrangle British Rail into convincing the new landowners to sell up."
"Unfortunately not, 257. From our discussions with British Rail, there is unfortunately no way that we will be able to relay the railway line back to our old connection at Horton, because the new landowners have already been creating housing estates on the trackbed, and it's absolutely nothing we can do about it, as they legally own that land now." The engines looked very sad to hear this, but Zeke was still smiling. "However, we have got some incredibly good news for you all, that it will take time and effort to implement. Now, as you all know, this railway has been through plenty of ups and downs over the years, and my own father, who built this railway initially, knew all about future-proofing the railway for future threats of operations. Now, as some of you remember, for a while, we closed Gallon Junction Station, but continued to be physically connected to the national network for freight operations, correct?
Some of the engines murmured their acknowledgement of this, curious as to why this detail was being brought up. Zeke took over. That connection was kept due to a contract drawn up in 1923 by the Dark Railway and the Southern Railway, orchestrated by my grandfather to make sure that the railway would continue to serve a purpose. Me and Dad had to go to see our lawyer to confirm this, but it turns out that this agreement has a clause, signed by the Southern Railway, stating that the Dark Railway had to retain a connection to the rest of the country's mainline railway network for a period of no less than 150 years. I was there on the 1st of January 1948 to countersign the agreement again with British Railways and the government, who did indeed sign the legislation stating that the railways must be connected at all costs, and only if we, the Dark Railway Company, chose to relinquish this agreement, could British Railways sever our connection. This agreement still holds up, legally, and is still binding, according to our law consultants. The engines were slightly confused at this. But if you're saying that they signed the agreement, then surely, by closing the line to Horton, they've acted legally.
Indeed it does. Then that means they surely have to give you the line back. It's not as easy as that, due to the new landowners, who also have legal rights now to that land. So why bring all this up then, if we're not able to get our mainline connection back to Horton? Because our legal team threatened to oust British Rail and sue their hot asses into Kingdom Come unless British Rail could come up with an acceptable alternative. An acceptable alternative? Raymond suddenly looked up, interested.
Hang on for a moment. Sirs, are you saying the old road?
The others looked incredibly bamboozled at this. Raymond looked around, explaining.
When I used to run the Red Herring with Turbo and Barry, we used to go down an old railway line beyond Coalhapper, at the junction where the railway used to split into separate lines, one for Horton, and the other went through a tunnel and onwards to a dockyard, where the fish trains were assembled. But that railway line was closed a while ago, so the trains were rerouted another way to Horton.
He looked down at Mr. Dark and Zeke.
Does that mean?
Yes, Raymond, you are correct.
That old line had been closed for several years, and has of course been ripped up. But British Rail retained ownership of the trackbed and derelict stations, seeming to have forgotten all about it whilst they began driving down services on the Horton line. Therefore, I pressed them further, and eventually they relented, and have agreed to sell us the entirety of the trackbed of the old line from Coalhapper Station itself, all the way down to the docks. I know it doesn't involve a mainline connection as of right now, but there is opportunities for us to reconnect to the mainline at that end at a later date. But there would be a long way to go. The tunnels, bridges and embankments would need to be repaired and strengthened. Track would need to be relaid, infrastructure would need to be reinstated, and the stations would require a lot of work to restore them. But for all intents and purposes, we now own the trackbed of that line, and we intend to restore it fully for passenger and freight operation. The engines erupted with excitement, shouting and screaming and making much noise. Mr. Dark and Zeke allowed them to calm down before proceeding. As a temporary measure, I'm going to be helping out around the railway for a while to help Zeke prepare for all of this. So I hope that we've been clear about our intentions, and we hope that we will all work hard to make sure the Dark Railway continues to prosper. The engine began talking excitedly, happily considering the extension. Except for Clyde. He had begun to worry again. If public attention was going to be focused on the Dark Railway again, then the risk of being seen by the general public, and possibly reported to British Rail, had increased. All he could hope for was that Fear and Otto would find him a solution, and quickly.